What I find very interesting about both of your books is that you both talk about two things that almost sound, if you saw them on paper, at odds. You talk about the beauty in tuning into sound and music and the power of that. Christine, you talk about the power of turning down the noise and honing in on the silence. But essentially, it's the same principle. Mm. It's being present. It's actively focusing on something, whether that be the sound that is around you or music that you tune into. Christine, what were some of the practical things that you find that I know that you outlined in your book in terms of finding the silence each day? When you don't need to go to the 10-day retreat, what are the practical things that we can do?
Yeah. So in my book I have slivers. I broke it up into slivers, slices and slabs of silence, meaning that not many people are going to be able to do a 10-day retreat. It took me about 10 years to actually organise my life to get to one. But we can... So we need to have those tools in the back of our mind for when we get those little slivers of time, and maybe a few practices that we can try and do daily, which are the, you know, the slices that are actually, you know, in our daily routine. So I would say, you know, first off, for people particularly, if you're not comfortable being on a meditation stool or cushion, is, you know, going for a walk somewhere that you feel good in nature, whether it's be by water or in bushland. I live deliberately now on a flora and fauna reserve in Brisbane, because you can walk and be surrounded by trees there very quickly. Don't take earpods. And to get to that state, because I think people, there's a jumping off point that stops a lot of people to get to where Mary was describing, because it's really confronting when you first have those racing thoughts and that sense of I should be somewhere else doing something. And that's your brain in survival mode telling you, you know, get this done, because it's used to operating like that. So what I say to people, if you feel confronted by just being alone, walking on a bush trail or by the harbour or on a beach, take yourself into a space where you actually actively name things. It sounds odd, but there's a tree. There's a wave. The breeze is hitting me there. That's an active process of grounding. And for some people, that's really useful, because it just gets you back out of your thoughts into your body, making you feel safe. It's okay, you're here. And then slowly you can start to do that thing of observing, where are these thoughts coming from? I don't need to buy into you have to do that right now or the world's going to end. Just observe it. What's it saying? Which is where Mary was going. So that's a good one, just giving yourself the breathing space of being out in nature, physically grounded. Some other ones I use are... there's one that I think in Buddhist terminology is the half moon meditation, but it's basically just a gentle smile. It can be with three breaths. So a smile, because it gives your body the signal that I am happy. Sometimes the cart goes before the horse. Usually something happens, we're happy, and then we smile. But if we smile, you can trick your body. Thinks, okay, I'm going to release some of those hormones, I feel good. And this can work even, you know, drop the kids off at school, driving to work, or I'm at a red light. You don't want to miss that red light, so lock your eyes on that red light. Face, smile. I'm not going to do it because I'll look crazy. three belly breaths, just regrounding. I do one for, and I loved this when I was working in the city here. Give yourself a little task, maybe once a week, of what I call the quiet quest. Go and find spaces. Make it fun, because if something's fun, you might do it again. Go and find a space that's quiet that you didn't know about in your lunch break. Rather than go to the really noisy food court or eat at your desk, today I'm going to go and find a quiet place. And I loved that, because you discover these little places in your own city or your own suburb that you didn't know, whether it's sitting at a park bench, you know, that overlooks something interesting, or, you know, you go to the state library if you're in the city. I mean, libraries and museums, you know, might be there for you to actually actively go and do something, but they're usually full of beautiful little quiet nooks. Sit on the grass in a park, but just find a space that you didn't know existed once a week. And again, what that does is it just brings you back into the present. It's not, oh my God, I have to meditate for half an hour. It's just letting your body enjoy being present, and it's taking you out of those thoughts.
Ritual is really important, and I think it's important that we talk a little bit about music and how we can use that in our lives in a really simple and easy way, because we all have access to headphones, Spotify. We can reach any single song that we want, and music is medicine, and we are the best doctors at prescribing ourselves a bit of medicine because we know what we need. You know, when we need to lift ourselves up, when we need to have a little cry, you know, when we can ask ourselves, you know, what do I need this morning? And we can create a little bit of a ritual around music and use that as a form of meditation or actually just developing a relationship with ourselves. So my ritual in the morning, I get up, I light a stick of incense, I say thank you for my day, you know, I sit down, I pull an angel card, just my little woo-woo thing that I do. And then, you know, I choose a song. And that could be, you know, I just want something to meet me where I'm at. So I, you know, I've designed a playlist that comes with my book. It's on Spotify. And it's something that people can really easily access, but it gets you in touch with your emotions. Mm. So we suppress a lot and we're not really feeling all the feels. And I think we need to feel to heal. And we're carrying a lot of baggage that we need to unpack. And sometimes we just wake up and we're not really feeling with it. So music needs to meet us, you know, it can meet us where we're at. It doesn't really ask anything from us, doesn't have any expectations. It's just our friend that can accompany us. And as we really listen and really give it our full attention, not trying to do other things at the same time, we can just be with it. And at the least, we're appreciating what a beautiful song it is. Mm. But at the very most, we're understanding how we're feeling that day. And we're saying, again, hi, how are you? What's going on today? And we're accepting ourselves the way we are. So, you know, these little things around music, and it's not about being better. When we use these tools, it's not necessarily about feeling better. In my opinion, as a psychologist, it's about learning how to feel and letting us be however we are. Not better, just as we are. And when we accept ourselves, that's when we can learn to value ourselves more. This is the basis of self-love and self-respect. These aren't really floaty terms. Actually, when we bring it back down, we're just saying, okay, I'm feeling this and I'm thinking this and my body feels like this, and that's totally cool. So we should be our own DJs. And it's so much easier to do that when sometimes meditating, I used to meditate a lot in silence, and it's really hard to just get super distracted. But, you know, one song, headphones, simple. We've got that.
Transformational.